Okay, I'll go on.
Okay, so the first question was, can you go over the derivative triangles? Now, for some of you finance students, who's a finance student? And then the rest of you are not. In finance, there's these things called derivatives. They're financially engineered product, and are basically standardized and used by all corporations of a certain size. You have to use them. So the development of property derivatives, property indexes, property price indexes, started in 2005. Yes, they were the early development, and you guys could be writing notes on this, the early development of property price indexes. The first one started in 1980 called the Nacreev Index. And then price indexes started being introduced in 2005. Okay. And they were out of London. And the first property derivatives were traded on the London Office Price Index. So the first property derivatives ever developed were out of London based on what was called the IPD Index. Okay? And then what they did was we partnered with Charles Schwab and Standard & Poor's, and they hired us to develop the first price indexes, other price indexes for the United States. And launch the property derivative market and bring the real estate market into the modern capital markets. But unfortunately, all of the indexes were wound down and the derivatives never adopted after the financial crisis. But still, it's still theoretically correct. So if I think, let's say I'm an institutional investor, can we sit up here? Let's say I'm an institutional investor in real estate. I'm CalPERS, California Retirement System. We're like $1 trillion in assets under management. We probably own like $25 billion in real estate assets, at least $25 million. Let's say that we want to buy another $25 billion of real estate. Well, that's going to take us maybe 20 years. Because there's not enough physical time. But theoretically, if the property derivative markets were in place, then we could have bought $25 billion of these derivatives within maybe 2 weeks or a month instead of 20 years. If the market had ever been developed. And if we thought that the $25 billion that we owned, the value of those properties were going to go down because of the recession, we could have used property derivatives to hedge off the market risk, and we would have made money on the derivatives to compensate us for the loss in the value of the portfolio. It would have been awesome. Okay. So if we think that the prices of real estate are going to go up, there's one set of traits. So we can trade off of real estate price indexes. We can still do that out of London, based on the London office market. And we can actually trade derivatives on valuation indexes across the globe in certain countries, because there's a provider of the index that does the calculation. So the market does exist, but it doesn't exist here in the United States. So if we think the prices are going to go up, we can buy forward contracts. We can buy futures contracts. And again, if you don't pick up the methodology or you don't pick up the definition of these things, you can always Google it. Google forward contracts. Futures contracts. Okay? Your generation has access to information instantaneously. So if you have a question about anything, you can look it up on your phone and know what it is in 2 seconds, 20 seconds. I could do that. I could also buy calls. These are your index rates. And what I can do too, right now actually, what I can do right now, because there's none of this available, but there is, if I think that the prices of real estate are going to go up, then I'm going to logically think price of real estate investment trust securities, shares, are also going to come up because they're highly correlated. And if I think that office prices, industrial prices, retail prices, apartment prices are going to go up, then I'm probably going to, I'm going to think, I'm going to assume that these real estate investment trust share prices are also going to go up. Because the their underlying portfolio is the property. So if the property values are going to go up, the share values are going to go up. And if I think that those prices are going to go up, both the property prices and the share prices are going to go up, I can call up my broker and I can say, hey, will you buy me some exchange-traded funds? And exchange-traded funds are basically companies whose shares are put into a fund, and the fund, the portfolio, trades as a security on the stock exchange. Okay? Trades as a security on the stock exchange. So again, if I think, so if I think that office, industrial, I think that office, industrial, retail, apartments, prices are going to go up, and the REIT share prices are going to go up. And I can call my broker. I can call my broker and I can say, give me a favor. Buy these ETFs on the market. So I'm not buying the underlying security. What I'm telling them to do is buy the underlying security, but margin it. Borrow some money. So I got $100,000. I want to buy $200,000 of these exchange-traded funds. I borrow $100,000 from the broker-dealer, and I pay him 9% interest on my borrowed money. Now I can buy $200,000 worth of securities instead of $100,000 worth of securities because I'm buying on margin. So if the price goes up, my return on equity goes up. And I make a ton more money because I'm controlling more securities. Okay. I can also buy call options. I can also buy calls. So I can call my options broker and I can say, hey, buy me some call options on these exchange traded funds. So that when the price of the underlying real estate goes up and the price of the REIT shares go up, and the price of the REIT shares within the ETF goes up, then I'm going to make money by buying the call. That's a derivative contract. That's a derivative. What I can also do is I can also write put options. When I buy the call option, I'm going to pay a premium. I'm going to pay a premium. So money's going out of my pocket. And then as the share price goes up, I'm going to reach a break even that pays me back for the premium that I paid out. And then as the share price continues to go up, above what is called the exercise price, this is the difference. It's going to be my profit that I'm going to make. So that's how you make money on a call option. Because I think that the prices are going to go up, pay the premium to buy the call option, and as the price goes up, I'm going to be in the money, and that's going to be my profit. Between the exercise price, let's say I can buy $10, and it goes to $20. I exercise it at 10, I sell it at 20, make a profit.
Can you write all of
them? Yeah, but I'll go through that. But just remember when you write the put, option, money goes into your pocket. When you buy the call option, money goes out of your pocket. When you write the put, so this could be either writing the put, or buying the call. If you write the put, the money goes in your pocket. If you buy the call, money goes out of your pocket. So if you want to bet, I mean, can you buy 25, can you buy, test question, can you buy $15 million worth of real estate office properties? Sure. Can you buy $15 million worth of office properties? Right there.
Yeah. Well, if you finance it, right?
You can buy 15 million. You.
Oh, you're asking me?
Yes.
That's personal. Oh, that's
No, you can't, right? But can you buy exchange traded funds of properties that own office buildings that have at least $25 million?
Yes.
Yeah. So theoretically, you can buy $25 million worth of real estate by buying the exchange traded funds. And if you know a direction the prices are going to go, you can buy a call option or write a put option, and you're going to make money. And the reason why you would buy these shares on margin, and why you would buy calls and write puts, is through the leverage effect. I can have $100,000, and I can leverage that 10 times and basically control $1 million. $1 million worth of shares, I can control $1 million worth of shares with $100,000 by trading option contracts. That's why people trade option contracts, because you can control more. You don't own it, you basically are trading the direction. You're just betting on what direction it goes. And the option contracts only last 3 months. So at the end of the 3 months, if the price doesn't go up high enough where you're in the money, you lose the money. And if you wrote the put option, and you have the money in your pocket, and the thing never materializes, then you get to keep the money when the option expires.
If it's not in the money?
Yeah, if it's not in the money.
Then you lose your
let's say the price only goes to a year, never goes high enough, then if you bought the premium, you lose the premium. If you wrote the option, then you get to keep it.
So if you hadn't wrote the put, you wouldn't keep it, right?
Yeah, if you wrote the put, you have to keep the money. If you bought the call option, you lose your money. Keep it or you lose it. You have to remember the call options are when you, if the price goes up, that's when you make money. Same thing when you write a put option. Because the flip is the other way around, and I'll do that in a minute. But the ETFs, the trades for the stocks, are exactly the same. So can I go call my broker? I think office prices are going to go up because rental growth rate is really high, and employment is growing really fast, occupancy rates are going up, vacancy rates are going down, concessions are being burned off. I think office values are going to go up. Will you buy me Kilroy stock? Kilroy, it's like in Boston Properties, are one of the biggest office REITs out there. They basically own, I don't know, $8 to $12 billion worth of real estate. Can I call my broker up and ask him to buy the shares in those office REITs?
Yes.
Yeah, if office prices go up, what's going to happen to their share prices? Oh. They're going to go up, so what would be my trades? I'm going to buy the shares on margin, buy calls, I'm going to write notes. When I do this, I own nothing. When I own that, I own the shares, but I'm using margin. So if the shares actually go down, I'm losing money. I'm going to get a margin call. Broker dealer is going to call me and say, hey, either you put up some money or I'm going to sell the securities to pay off the loan. Then I'm going to liquidate your account.
So you don't keep the premium if it's not in the money by expiration? You lose all your money if it's not in the money?
Yeah, if you bought the call option and it doesn't get in the money, then you lose the premium. Because you paid the premium, you bought the call option.
No, I understand that you lose it for the
basically the same. These are the same terms. And that's when you think the prices are going to go up. Right? So I can trade real estate. Basically, I can trade real estate without buying the real estate. I can trade real estate based on my view by buying and selling the securities or trading the option contracts. So if you guys are really good at real estate economics and finance, and you're saying, God, you know, things are really good in the apartment market here in the Bay Area, I think that, you know, rental rates and values are going to continue to go up for the next 2 years. What I'm going to do is I'm going to start buying some apartment REIT shares or some apartment exchange traded funds, and I'm going to buy them on margin, and I'm going to buy call options and rent put options on those exchange traded funds and on those apartment REIT shares, and I'm going to make money doing it that way. So basically, you can trade real estate without even buying any underlying real estate, which I think is pretty awesome. I would just get started. Most of these shares probably trade between $25 and $125 each. So you can just start, you know, buying some shares just to get a feel for it, do some due diligence, read the prospectus, read the 10-Ks, read the annual reports, listen to the conference calls, do the market research. You know, if it's an apartment REIT, do the market research, you know, on the apartment markets, where the portfolio is located, come up with a view on where it's going to go. You can either buy the stock, buy it on margin, buy the calls or rent calls. It depends on how much experience you have to be able to do this stuff. You can lose money pretty quickly. But once you get a good feel for the company and a good feel for the market, then you should be able to come up with a view, and if you're right, you can make more money quicker. Yes? Yeah. Yeah, I have Kilroy, I have Boston Properties, I have Prologis, Essex Property Company. Yeah, I can, well, usually what I do is I buy the top companies within the sector. So if you go to the National Association of Real Estate Investment Trusts. Actually, the last part of our class, what we're going to do is we're going to pick a REIT, and we're going to do the research. We're going to value the research, so we can apply this stuff. I'm just teaching the theory now. So anyway, if you go up there and you're going to research the research reports, and they will have basically a table that shows the top REITs for office, you know, industrial, apartments, retail, they might even have storage. So then what your strategy is going to be, okay, what do I buy? What companies do I buy? Well, I can buy large cap. So basically pick the top five companies by sector. So I can do that. So that would be a pretty conservative approach. Those are really good companies, they're not going away. So it's, you know, high-tech firms are pretty volatile. These are like real estate, they're money machines that sit on the land. They basically lease out space, sign leases, generate constant cash flow, and then because they're plowing so much money into the property over time, using inflation-adjusted dollars, the resale value of the property goes up with inflation. The rents usually go up with inflation, so real estate is a nice, durable income and capital appreciation asset class. So if you're like a tortoise, I'm a tortoise, there's hares, people like to make a lot of money, I want to make 20% to 40%, great, go ahead, go do that. Just give me 8% to 10% rate of return for the rest of the day, and I'll still win. We'll call it a good business.
Okay, what did that say?
Large cap. These are the largest companies by market capitalization within the different sectors. So I can do that. If I want to get a higher rate of return, but I'm willing to take on more risk, then I'll do mid cap. So these are mid-sized companies. And then if you want to be really risky, I want small cap REITs and I probably want to trade them. They're going to be highly volatile. But again, they'll probably have a higher return at the end of the day, but the volatility is going to be a lot higher because they're smaller.
Is it because they're growing? Is that why it's more volatile?
Because well, because they just have, they're just smaller companies, so they're more sensitive to movements in the economy. These companies have better balance sheets, larger portfolio, but these guys are global. These are like really large companies. You know, 18 billion, 10 billion. These are probably 5 billion. And these are under 2 billion. So that's kind of a long answer to that question, but it kind of gets into what we're going in the class. So what do I think the prices are going to go down?
But it's the opposite.
Okay. You do pretty much the opposite. Okay, but it's not totally the opposite, but it is kind of the opposite. Okay, just watch out behind. All right. So if I think real estate prices, I think real estate prices are going to go down, in what direction do you think ETF and REIT share prices are going to go?
Down.
They're going to go down. If there were any indexes, which there really aren't, and there's no derivatives other than the option contracts, if there were property price indexes in which these derivatives were traded off of, we would write forwards. We would write futures. And then you're right, you do the opposite. You're gonna write the calls on the futures. And you're gonna buy the puts on the futures. Now how do you feel if you had a portfolio of REIT exchange traded funds, if you had a portfolio of REIT shares? And the prices were going down, would you be happy?
No.
No. Would you be sad?
Yeah.
Yeah. But what if you think that the REIT ETFs and the REIT shares are something that you would want to hold for a long term, but you think that the prices are going to correct within the next 6 to 9 months? I don't want to sell them, right? I want to keep them, but I want to protect myself from the downside. So what I could do for the ETFs, or if you think that real estate prices are going to go down and you know ETF prices and REIT shares are going to go down, I can sell short the stock. And when you sell short, you're basically lending somebody the shares. So the price gets to a certain price, I think they're going to go down, I'm going to lend them the shares. I'm going to sell short, they're going to pay me the market price, and then when the share prices go down, at some point the person starts waving the white flag and says, I'm out. And you go back and you buy the share prices at the lower price. So you sold high and bought low. So you can make money that way. I can also write a call option. Again, it's different than buying a call, I write a call. And what I can do is I can buy a put. I can buy calls, and I can buy puts. And I buy puts, I'm paying out the premium, and I'm writing the calls, I'm stuffing money in my pocket. And this is the way that it looks like this. It's just the opposite. So if I buy the put, by the put, you're going to pay the premium. But as the ETF price and the share prices go down, I'm making money. Let's say the share price goes to $5. Then I can sell it at 10. That's my exercise price. So my profit is going to be $5. So I can make money. I can make money when prices go up, I can make money when prices go down, I can make prices when they turn, go sideways. I can make money in any market if I'm right, if I can forecast right. And then for the stocks, I can basically implement the same trade. If I own individual shares of REIT securities, and I think the prices are going to go down, I can sell short the shares and make money when the prices go down. I can write calls when the prices go down. And I can buy puts.
So are ETFs and stocks, are they always going to mirror each other? Like
pretty closely. So here's like your ETF. This is my ETF portfolio. And this is my stock. This is basically a portfolio of these guys. Okay. And let's say this is office. So I'm going to have a bunch of office REITs. So these stocks as a portfolio are put into an exchange-traded fund, and this exchange-traded fund shares trade, and they trade just like these stock shares.
But they trade them together?
So, if, this is a portfolio, this is an individual stock. So this is a portfolio of a bunch of office REITs, in a portfolio called an exchange traded fund, and these shares trade on the New York Stock Exchange.
Okay.
And these shares individually trade on the New York Stock Exchange. So if I think that office prices in the US are gonna go down, right? I can short the office ETF, and I can short the office stocks.
So you would sell short, right?
Yeah, I can sell short. So I can do the exact, I can do the same trade strategies for the individual stocks as I can for the exchange traded funds. Okay. So I can trade real estate. $300?
Maybe.
Maybe. Or how about $3,000 worth of REIT stocks? Or maybe $30,000 in a retirement account? Or maybe $300,000 in REIT shares and REIT ETFs in your retirement account, your self-directed IRA? Can you do that?
Maybe.
Can you do that?
Yeah.
Yeah, you can do that. So you can own real estate. Maybe you can't buy it directly, but you can buy the shares of the ETFs and the individual REIT shares, and now you own a portion of a $25 billion portfolio of a publicly traded company that provides you with information on a quarterly basis and does an annual report and then does annual conference calls. If you know where the underlying markets are going to go, you're going to know where the share prices are going.
I think it's also important to note, like, generally speaking, the ETFs, how they move, generally determine how the actual stocks move as well.
Right? Yeah, so if I have some really large cap stocks in the ETF, then any movement in these large cap companies are going to move the ETF. So if I know the direction of these large cap stocks and how much they make up of the ETF, if I know where these guys are going, I know where this guy's going. I can forecast the ETF share prices.
And then the question is, how do you determine like what percentage of your portfolio do you want to wear?
How would you allocate?
Yeah, like how would you go about that?
Like how much of your portfolio do you have in the individual stocks or in the ETFs?
Yeah.
Well, one way to do it is you can do sector allocation. So you can figure out what the market cap is in each one of these sectors for those REITs. The majority are their office. You'd be able to use 30% of my portfolio in office. You'd be able to do 30% of my portfolio in office. Right? I do 20% in industrial. That's 80. And then I do 10% in retail and 10% in storage. That could be one way of doing it. Because I think that the office market and the apartment market is going to do well over the long run, so I'm going to have a bigger allocation. I think industrial is going to do better than retail and storage, so I'm going to have a bigger allocation. And then I get the rest of retail and storage. So then I can just buy REITs within these different sectors, okay, based on this allocation. And then just let it ride, or you can trade it if you want to. It depends. But that's a quick and dirty way to get into an allocation. That's acceptable. Who came in late? He's going to pick this up. Okay, did you get copies of this? Anybody else? Anybody else? I thought I saw a second video.
Okay. You like it? Go ahead.
I like vodka better. Okay, so what's the next question? I think that answered your question. Oh wait, the last piece here is here the buying the puts and writing the calls. When you buy the put, money goes out. And when you write the call, money goes in. So if I think prices have gone down, I buy the put and write the calls. Prices are going up. I'm going to buy the calls and rent. This is a real estate valuation course. This is really a real estate valuation course, and it includes securities, not just real estate. And it's usually taught just as a valuation course, but you can't have valuation without valuing securities. It's such a huge, huge part of the market. So, what other question on the exam? You should be writing notes on in your exam right now, and use a blue pen or red pen, something else, and you can see that you're adding notes to your exam. That's what I'm looking for. What else? What other questions on the exam?
No other questions on the exam? So everybody got the efficient frontier correct, the technical analysis, you got the cycle analysis, you guys nailed all that stuff. Because when I ask you back tonight, when I review all that stuff, it's not correct yet, but I'm going to send you back, you're going to have to go back. Unless you want to get a C in the class, but I don't get a C, so you can have some time. Yes. Yeah, there's a blue book right there. Okay, everybody got this?
You were just going over this a bit. Right?
Yeah, I just finished it. Simon Properties is better. These guys are retail. There's a bunch of other ones.
Simon Properties
is a retail. Those guys are good. Crown Lodges is awesome. Essex now, Avalon Bay, Essex actually bought my old company. And then Kilroy came into the San Francisco market about 10 years ago, and then Boston Properties bought the market of centers in the mid-1990s. Those guys are
good.
I'm a buy and hold guy. I think those guys will be around forever. So my cash flow and my appreciation. So what was the question? And you guys should take pictures of this before I start the race. Give me long pictures.
What's that last one called?
This one's Prologis. Prologis.
Prologis.
Actually, a lot of these things were overvalued like 2 years ago. And they came off their peak. You see they're stabilized. They usually hold up pretty well in those sessions. Prologis. P-R-O-L-O-G-I-S. Prologis. It used to be called A and B.
A and B.
It used to be called A and B. After the principals had launched their company. These guys were thrilled. Yeah, really, really.
Yeah.
Because they took their company from $2 billion to $18 billion in about 15 years.
Nice.
So what was the other one? Oh, the dynamics, the supply demand analysis. Can I see the question? Prices of commodities and stuff like that. That's how the supply demand works.
Do you want the notes?
Yeah, you should be adding the notes right now. Yeah, the one you're going to turn. The one that's been cleaned up and everything. So I go back, add some more stuff to it. So that when I take a look at it later, if it looks good, I'll keep it, and if not, I'll say, okay, go back in it. A little bit more detail, go back in it. Because what I'm trying to do is get everybody up to the same level. Right? Nobody gets left behind in my class. So I'm not going to go ahead and leave you
behind.
So this is how it usually looks with commodity prices. But in real estate, it's different. Okay? Your supply curve is completely in the short term. In the short term, supply curve is perfectly inelastic. Perfectly inelastic. So can the real estate market, here's an example. I'm an investment banker. My client calls me up, says, we want to issue, you know, $2 billion worth of shares. How long do you think that would take if I was Google?
Google?
Call Goldman Sachs and say, we want to issue $2 billion worth of stock. How long do you think it would take to underwrite the deal and bring the issue to market?
30 days.
Yeah, probably like 30 days. How long will it take to build the TransBay terminal center?
3 years?
Yeah, it took like 10 years. So you can't just bring real estate to market very quickly. So that's why the supply curve is completely inelastic, okay, in the short term. And then you're going to start off in some equilibrium. Quantity supply. Then you get your demand curve. Market basically is in equilibrium. And then usually what will happen is the economy will start to take off. net absorption, higher occupancy rates, higher rental rates, and higher prices. Then the demand curve is shocked, moves up, since the supply doesn't respond, you're going to get what are called price spikes. So far? Because of the economy started to, you have GDP was growing, production increased, you need to hire more people, you hire more people, you absorb more space, you absorb more space, occupancy rates go up, rental rates go up, and then prices go up. Okay? And then what happens is over time, what will happen is the new construction coming to the marketplace. This is supply, right? In the long term, what happens is the supply of new construction will come into the marketplace. And then what will happen is the appreciation rates, the prices fall, and the market will go back into equilibrium. Now, what can happen, and this is, extend this. So what if you live in Sacramento, Tucson, Albuquerque, Dallas, Texas, Fort Lauderdale, Atlanta? Is there a lot of land in those places in Sacramento, Fresno, Stockton, Nevada? Those are commodity fields. Those are commodity fields. And what happens is supply growth shifts out because they use construction in those municipalities. They use construction for economic development purposes. Because as they build more real estate, they get more tax revenue. So they're promoting real estate development in those commodity markets. And what happens is they are permitting all this new construction. And what happens is the market gets oversupplied. The market gets oversupplied. And actually, prices and appreciation rates actually start to fall and turn negative. Supply constraint. That's going to be New York, Boston, LA, San Francisco, all major centers, all major centers. So, since the supply curves are constrained, also due to NIMBYism, and also regulation, environmental CEQA, all these things basically create supply constraints. For these markets, so the supply curve is constrained and doesn't reach equilibrium. So basically, the prices and the price appreciation rates, the equilibrium point settles at a higher price. And the prices appreciate well above the local inflation rate in supply constrained markets. And we just happen to live in San Francisco is a perfect supply constrained market. Oakland to a certain degree, but definitely San Francisco, some supply constraint. It's higher because the supply curve can't shift out of the equilibrium.
So I'm saying it's priced higher in the location.
It will always be higher, the appreciation rates will always be well above the local inflation rate because of the supply constraints. It's a supply constraint market.
So
as opposed to the commodity markets, that would be subject to falling prices and actually appreciation.
So certain
basis.
It's basically priced higher than what you
want. The price is going to be higher. And the appreciation rates would be higher. But the investors will still come in, but it's just harder to buy and harder to build in supply constrained markets. So those REITs that I showed you, they buy in supply constrained markets. That's why they outperform over the long run. Those aren't REITs that buy properties in commodity markets. They buy properties in supply constrained markets. That's why their share prices have appreciated further and faster over the years, because they know how to buy in supply-constrained markets. In supply-constrained markets, at higher prices over the long run, when the prices appreciate well above the local inflation rate over the long run.
So it's a strategy. So the big caps, they can't even buy there, or some of the...
Some of the REITs can't buy in.
You can buy there.
Yeah, you, the very large REITs can buy in these, Boston Properties built Salesforce Tower. That thing's got to be at least $2 billion. Some of the ones in New York are $4 billion. $4 billion prices. That's nothing. And then you go to Hong Kong, you go to Taipei, you go to those places. It's a whole different game in Asia. A whole totally different game. Okay, so I think that answered that question. Okay. And I don't think I went over last time. So any other questions? On the exam, here's your chance. How long are we going to do that today? Yeah, we're going to do this. We're going to do the last page. They kick off our valuation exposure. Start now, because we've done a lot of presentations, we've done some research, learn the product types, and now let's learn how to value some properties. Let's learn how to walk through valuation process. So I'll walk you through the initial valuation process, and then as you start to do the presentations for the chapters on the next two books, you're going to be working in Excel, so you're going to basically be presenting the Excel to us in the chapters. Teach us Excel. You don't necessarily need to run them, but just show us the equations, walk us through the logic. So we're exposed to the worksheets.
Can you do the modern and postmodern real estate portfolio?
Yeah, I can do that. Anybody else? Any others? Okay, you want to take a picture of this, or is that good enough?
I want to take a picture.
Got it. That's exactly what you should be doing. Right.
So the last one is the commodity market.
So again, you start off in equilibrium, which elastic supply curve. You get a demand shock, the prices go up. Prices are above the cost of construction, new construction starts to come in, and then the market moves back to equilibrium. Then in commodity markets, since there's so much land, they over-permit, they overconstruct, the supply curve overshoots, and prices start to fall. In supply constrained markets, somewhere in between the equilibrium supply curve and the vicious supply curve, that's your supply constraint. Supply curve, prices can't fall to the long run equilibrium. They're constrained at a higher price and a higher depreciation rate because of constraints. In that question, do I ask you to list commodity and supply constraint markets? Can I ask you to mention them? Any questions?
Yes.
I do? Okay, so give me five examples of commodity markets.
Tucson, Albuquerque.
Give me five supply constraint markets.
LA, San Francisco,
New York.
Chicago.
Maybe.
Boston.
Yeah. Oh, and Seattle. So those are the top. If I focused when I was doing this stuff, we were focused on supply constraint markets. We were focused on supply constraint markets. Yeah, over the long run. And some other companies would play in the commodity markets, but they always got burned. Because they had the time to work. So they'd come in, the market would boom, they'd race to build product, and then all of a sudden the economy would go down, the supply would hit, and they'd lose their share. So I can erase this. Hey, why would you put real estate in a stock bond portfolio? This is a thesis question on this. Why would you put real estate? I was building a multi-asset portfolio. Stocks, bonds, and real estate. Why would I put real estate in my stock bond portfolio?
One is diversification. You'd be able to lower risk through diversification. But what are the correlations of real estate returns compared to stock and bond returns?
Negative correlation.
Well, they could be negative or negative three reasons. Why would I add real estate in my stock bond portfolio? Because real estate returns have what the stocks and bond returns. You said it. Yeah, you did. You just said it. Negative correlation is the other correlation. Okay, negative correlation is four types of correlation. Why would I do that? Could I get diversification if the real estate returns are positively correlated in stocks and bonds? But I get diversification if we have negative correlation? Yes. What are the other two correlations where I would get diversification by adding real estate to my stock and bond? What are the other two correlations? Positive? No. It's negative. Okay. I could also add what?
Positive.
No. No? Okay, what kind of correlation is this? What kind of correlation is this?
Positive.
What kind of correlation is this? What kind of correlation is this?
Flat.
Is it flat or called the field curve?
Flat.
What is it?
Zero.
Correlation.
Zero.
Okay. What about this?
Marginal.
Would that be high, low, or negative?
Low.
Got it. And then would this be positive, negative, or no correlation?
No correlation.
I'm teaching you terminology. Okay. So we have real estate in the stock bond portfolio because the rates of returns on real estate have low, no, and negative correlation precisely. So that's what you got. Write down and memorize in your brain.
Is that how it's
Yes. However, there is positive correlation between stock prices and real estate prices too, but with a lag. So they're not perfectly correlated. So we want to do the modern real estate portfolio theory. Postmodern real estate portfolio theory. So you guys got to draw this out, right? Because I've already looked at some of your handouts in your modern real estate portfolio, so it's just that. What's the second line item when you're reading the job description? What's the second thing on the job description? What does it say? He should have what's usually the second one on the list? They should have not just punctuality and politeness. What's one of the top skill sets that they're looking for? What? Attention. When I look at these things, I'm looking at attention to detail. So this is how I do this. You may want to watch this. Because maybe one of these days you're going to be teaching here, teaching your own thing. You probably won't be teaching the way I teach. Most people teach from the bottom. They teach the stuff that I've done in 15 years. So this is your capital allocation line. This is your risk-free rate. So that's how I do it. This is going to be your expected return on the portfolio. And we're doing a multi-asset portfolio. This is your capital obligation. This is your risk-free rate, or your 10-year treasury. And then what I do is I go right here, and it's got to be exactly like that. Because if you do it any other way, it's not going to work. You didn't get anything. Okay? And what you do is you put in the official frontier umbrella. Okay? What I do is I go, okay, so we're going to start off with 100% stock. Here's 100% bonds. And I'm looking for this too. A lot of people don't, for some reason, don't like to put these in. This is my expected return stocks. And this is my expected return on bonds. This is going to be my standard deviation from the bond portfolio. Standard deviation for the stock portfolio. This one right here is the standard deviation portfolio. This is the market basket. This is my expected return portfolio. And then what I do is I go right here. Actually, let's see this first. So I put these little dots right here, along with the official frontier, and right here on the umbrella. And I put some dots right here along the official frontier. And I put dots in here. So any dot along the official frontier, or any dot in the official frontier, are actual They're actual portfolios that I can construct using assets in the marketplace. Okay. I can't construct any portfolios out here, and I can't construct them out here. Why would I put together a portfolio with high risk and low return? Nobody's going to buy that. Right? So they're infeasible portfolios outside the official criteria. And then what I do is like here, right here like this, and I go, that, and I put another utility curve here, and I put another utility curve here. These are utility curves. The investors want to be out here, high return, low risk, but they can't get there. Because there's no portfolios out there. So what they have to do is they have to lower their utility. And they lower their utility to the point where the utility curve is tangent to the capital allocation line and in the efficient frontier. Then, let's say I'm an investor. And I haven't even introduced real estate into the portfolio yet. We're still doing stocks and bonds. So let's say I want a higher rate of return and I'm willing to tolerate more risk. I'm going to sell off my bonds and I'm going to increase my allocation to stocks. If I'm an investor and I don't like risk and I'm willing to take a lower rate of return, I'm going to sell off my stocks and move in my own bonds. I'm going to bring down the efficient return. So I can do that. Start those portfolios. And then what's cool, which you can do too, is you can jump off the efficient frontier. You can jump off the efficient frontier onto the capital allocation line. And move up the capital allocation line. Applying leverage. And if I'm applying leverage to my stock portfolio, I'm buying the stock on the margin. And if I want to leverage my equity in my real estate, I slap a mortgage on it. Put a mortgage on it. Leverage it. It's a mortgage. And if I do that, if I apply margin and apply mortgage, I'm going to significantly increase the volatility and the risk of my portfolio, but I'm also going to get higher expected return. I can do that too. I can also on a bank, banks don't like risk. Banks don't like to lose money. So what they'll do is they will lend you the money. Broker dealers will lend you the money for your margin account to buy your stock. Banks will lend you the money to buy the real estate for the mortgage. So they'll give you the money under one stipulation. The stocks and the real estate are collateral to the loan. So if you default on the mortgage, they will foreclose on you and take your property. And in the margin account, they're more than happy to give you the money to buy the stock on margin. But if the stock prices go down, you're going to get a margin call. And if you don't put up any equity into the account, they're going to liquidate the shares to pay off the margin loan.
I have a question for you. When you think, like, what determines, like, when you should use margin? Of course, anybody can
use you look, margin. You use margin when you think you're right.
But it can't be when you think you're right, because if you're wrong,
you're using leverage. You have a view that prices are going to go up. If you're right, you use leverage, because now you can buy more of the asset, put up less of the equity, and get a higher return on equity.
I guess my question is, like,
when you know you're going to be right.
Yeah, when you...
Because if you're wrong, you're going to lose your property, you're going to lose your stock market.
You can lose everything.
You can lose everyone. People lose money all the time in the stock market and in the real estate.
No, I understand that. When you deem yourself ready for using leverage, you know?
When you understand the market and you understand your investments, then you can use leverage. If you don't use leverage. You'll lose your money. You make a bad bet, you lose your money. But some investors don't care. Because they buy a property, they lever it up, but property appreciates over time. They basically refinance the property, they pull money out tax-free. They basically pull out more money than they actually put into the property. And then when the market goes down, they basically default on the loan to pocket the money. Mm-hmm. The bank comes and forecloses on the property, takes the property. Do they care? No, because they already pulled more money out than they put in. And they just say, go ahead and pay it. Take the property. So hold on, let me finish this. So through the process of lending, you can also jump off the efficient frontier, move down the capital allocation line, and have a portfolio with significantly less risk, but you're also getting significantly less return. Banks are averse to risk more than return. So they're willing to take lower returns for significantly lower risk.
That's lending.
That's lending. So this is the process of lending. Okay. Yes, did you have a question?
Yeah, just going back to what you were just saying about these guys defaulting. They already pulled money out anyway. So
they refinanced the property. The property went from $1 million to $2 million.
So
they basically cashed out $1 million.
When people,
property came, the bank, you know, after defaulting on the loan, they pocket more cash. Then the bank says, we're going to foreclose on it. It's like, fine, I already pulled out $1 million.
Are these people just regular people messing up their own credit, or is there another way they're doing this where it's like they're ruining, they're doing it through a company and the company's...
Yeah, they are ruining their credit, that they walked away with a lot of money. Some people say, screw it, I don't care, right? I'm going to screw over three banks, I'll pull up $30 million, whatever, I'm done. You know, I'm just going to go move to that. But that's one like way that. To I don't believe in that, but, you know, some people do that. Some people are motivated by money.
I was just wondering, are there people who set up, like, companies and do that in the name of the company, and then they walk away with no ding to their own personal record?
Yeah, those are called criminals.
but is that something that happens?
Occasionally, but those are criminal people or unethical people, and then eventually we'll all hear about them and we'll do business with them again.
What did he say?
And maybe they move to another state or something like that. Yeah, real estate, you're controlling a huge, an asset that's worth a lot of money, so there's an incentive. Cheat can be somewhat criminal in the practice, so you have to be really super careful who you relate to, who you do business with. Because the last thing I want to do is to do business with somebody who's unethical or has a criminal background, because I will just destroy my reputation. My reputation will matter. Okay. Did I answer all your questions? So that's that. So now for this one. At this market basket, this point right here, the expected return on the portfolio divided by the portfolio standard deviation, you are going to maximize your risk-adjusted rate of return. At that point, we're going to maximize the return to risk ratio. Your annual return divided by the portfolio standard deviation. So you're going to maximize it. All right. So let's talk about real estate for a minute. So what is the real estate? About real estate returns, the stock and bond returns. What does real estate returns have with stock and bond returns?
Negative.
the real estate returns have low, no, and negative correlation with stock and bond returns. So if I add real estate into a stock bond portfolio, I'm going to get diversification. So here's the key, this is what I'm looking for. This has been documented in the last 20, 30 years in the literature through the correlation coefficients. I still have that with me. So what will happen is because real estate returns have low, no, and negative correlation with stock and bond returns, what happens is the portfolio, the efficient frontier, bows out. Okay. You want to say that? So it bows out the efficient frontier. And if the efficient frontier bows out, okay, obviously my expected return by adding real estate falls. Expected return goes down. But my portfolio standard deviation goes down even more. So if I hold my expected return on the portfolio constant, then I can reduce the portfolio standard deviation more than the reduction in the return. What happens to the risk-adjusted rate of return? Test question. If I add real estate to the stock bond portfolio, it blows out the efficient frontier, reduces the expected return on the portfolio, reduces portfolio standard deviation even more than the reduction in the return, what happens to the risk-adjusted rate of return?
Goes up.
And am I better off? As an investor, a risk-averse investor, am I better off?
Yes.
By getting higher risk-adjusted rate of return? And here's the key to the whole thing. Most investors, you ask them, and obviously more return is good. A lot of investors don't want really high returns because they know they're taking on significantly more risk. Right? So there's really a limit to the amount of return most risk-averse investors would take. They don't want 55% or 100% returns because they know they're going to take on significantly amount of risk and they don't want to take on that much risk. So if you can get your investors an expected return on the portfolio of 8% to 10% based on the rule of 72, how many years does it take me to dump the money in the portfolio? 72 divided by 10,
that's
2 years.
So
if I can get my client an 8 to 10% rate of return on their portfolio, I can build the money in less than 10, the portfolio in less than 10 years. That's what they want. That's what most investors want. So if I can add real estate to stock bond portfolio and I can still get an expected return on the portfolio of 8 to 10% and lower the risk in the portfolio and increase the standard deviation and double their money in less than 10 years, we're in. We win. That's it. That's good. Okay.
It increases the standard deviation?
No. When you add real estate to the stock bond portfolio because the returns on real estate have low, no, and negative correlation of stocks and bonds, goes out the efficient frontier. Reduces the return, but reduces the risk even more. So the risk-adjusted rates of return go up. And if you can give them an 8 to 10% rate of return, your money doubles in less than 10 years. And if you're an institutional investor, or somebody who's building a portfolio for retirement, $1 million goes to $2 million, $4 million, $8 million in 40 years. That's the name of the game. It's the tortoise and the hare. Seen the hares get torched, cooked, down on the side, brought over by mouse. The tortoise just pops away, builds the portfolio, they win too. I'll just do it more methodically.
If the stock market's averaged 10% in the last whatever year.
The last 10 years is around 7.2 from the S&P 500.
Doing this, I mean, how much better off are you in trying to diversify so much instead of just buying and holding for like 20 years?
Real estate or stocks and bonds?
Stocks and bonds.
Yeah, that's a buy and hold strategy.
So when you're dealing with real estate, you're looking at maybe 3 to 5 year
strategy? No, my investors are looking at 20, maybe 30 years. When they buy their real estate, they use a 10-year pro forma to analyze to underwrite it, but they're mainly buying the property to own for at least maybe 20 to 40 years.
So
and sometimes they own it forever. They'll just go in and scrape. You know, if I owned a piece of property on Sand Hill Road that we bought in 1970, right? You know, Facebook, it's right down the street there. Yeah, so what we do is we just scrape the building and we rebuild it. Or we basically redevelop it. So the land is infinite, it's perpetual. We just have to update the amenities in the real estate to match the current market and refresh the product. It's the location at the end of the day is really the number one factor that drives long-term value for it.
I think my mom really made over $1 million thanks to gentrification.
Yeah, oh yeah, in Oakland or something?
Yeah.
Yeah, where was she, West Oakland?
He lived in an area called Maxwell Park, and then he changed the school in the whole neighborhood.
Yeah, they. Is it in the East Coast?
Yeah.
How far East Coast?
No. My grandmother lived over at East Coast.
Yeah, seminary and stuff.
Yeah,
because the basis was probably low. And then as Oakland started to be gentrified over the last 20 years, the prices just went through. But it was, you know, when I was a kid, that wasn't. It was an okay thing.
So,
in gentrification?
Yeah.
Well, you just being offered some money, and then as the prices get high enough, it's like, you know, a lot of people say, hey, you know, I'm going to take the money and I'm going to go to Atlanta. You know, I can buy a house for a fraction of it, and increase my lifestyle by trading into another state. That's, a lot of people made a ton of money in California, and then they arbitrage it by going out of state. If you're married, you can pocket $500,000 on the residential, $250,000 in single family, and you put it in your pocket without paying any taxes. Okay, any other questions? I do have one more piece on this thing. Okay, so here's the over the decades, the market baskets right here, this pen right here, has changed. Okay. As new asset classes came into vogue, right? So if I was building, if I was like 100 and something years old, I was basically a stockbroker between 1920 and 1970. And somebody came to me and said, Larry, my investment advisor, built me a portfolio. I would have 70% of my money in stock. And I would have the other 30%, sorry.
Bonds, yeah.
Bonds, thank you. Bonds, and the others. So that's all that was really available at that time period in the marketplace. And then from 1970 through 1980, the real estate basically introduced as another alternative asset class under ERISA, a company called Gibbonson & Associates. Did the research, went to the government, and recommended that Congress pass legislation called ERISA that basically said that all public and private pension plans should have at least 10% of their assets in direct real estate investment. So the basis. Real estate has bond-like characteristics. It took it from the bond allocation, and they kept the stock allocation. And then between 1980 and 1990, you had the real estate allocation. Gibbonson did some more research and said, okay, you gotta have 10% of your allocations in life insurance. And since life insurance has bond-like characteristics, we're going to take from the bond allocation, and we're going to keep the allocation. And then, 1990, probably wasn't even 1990, it was probably later, just 2018. Let's see, it was 10 years ago I started working on this. So in 2009, we started to see the emergence of alternative renewable energy. Solar panels, solar farms, what do they sit on?
Real estate.
What about geothermal plants?
Real estate.
What about biogas?
Real estate.
So basically, renewable energy is basically a real estate proxy. It looks like real estate, smells like real estate, it's a regulated market. It smells just like real estate. So, if it's in 10% real estate, 10% life insurance, and then Deutsche Bank, REIF, did the analytics. It says you have to have 10% of your portfolio alternative renewable energy. And we're going to take from the bonds, 40% bonds. And we're going to keep the 30% stock. This is going to be your target, or what is called your model portfolio. This is your generations model target portfolio. What did Jerry Brown do last week or 2 weeks ago? What did Jerry Brown do? He basically said we're going to get basically 100% of our energy from alternative renewables. That's policy. That's policy. Unless the feds come in, there's going to be like trillions and trillions of dollars being invested in alternative renewable energy. That's an emerging asset class. Do you want to be investing in established asset classes or emerging asset classes?
Emerging.
These asset classes right here, these are called alternative.
How about hemp? How do you feel about hemp or like that now that this is legal in certain places?
I don't know, I haven't figured it out.
You can use it for a dip popular.
Yeah, but it's not an asset class. You know, marijuana is just agriculture being grown in industrial facilities. So these are all part alternative assets. Now, do these alternative assets have low, no, and negative correlation with stock bond returns?
Yes.
Yes. So do they go up in efficient frontier?
Yes.
Yep. Do they lower the expected return? Do they lower the standard portfolio standard deviation by more?
Yes.
Does it increase the risk adjusted rate of return?
Yes.
You get an 8 to 10% rate of return when you build money in the portfolio in less than 10 years. So the last piece of the solution. This is the last piece of the solution. So I'm a real estate developer. Real estate owner. If I'm developing real estate or I own real estate, if I die tomorrow, is the portfolio going to be disrupted?
Yeah.
Yeah, because I'm the developer. So I'm developing a project. If I go BK, the project's going to be impaired. Because I'm the person that's managing the project, I came up with the concept, I need to do all the financing around it, and negotiating through basically the community, I'm negotiating with the city, you know. If I go away, they're going to have to hire 5 people to replace me to basically do the negotiation. So it's going to be extremely disruptive. But if I have life insurance and I die, I to hire five people to replace me with the death benefit, is it going to impair the development?
That's what I said.
No, it's not, because I can hire five people to replace me with the death benefit, so it mitigates the damage associated with the loss of the human capital. And what if I own real estate, and I'm managing my property pretty much by myself, or with my kids, or it's a small business, if I die, is that company going to be impaired?
Yeah.
Absolutely. But if the death benefit is in place, and injects liquidity into the company to hire people to replace me, will the damage be mitigated?
Yes.
Absolutely. So the prudent application is not only to build a portfolio with stocks, bonds, and real estate, but also apply the life insurance. And by use of the income and the proceeds from your real estate to buy life insurance on you. Because what happens is, if you die, the estate and the company is injected with the death benefit, and the death benefit basically jacks the return on the portfolio, and you end up on a higher utility curve and a significantly higher return due to the insurance. Brilliant. But my real estate guy's going to say, well, I'm already rich, I have earned up with life insurance. I don't believe him. Until they get cancer, and they say, well, you know, I don't think I'm going to make it very long. That life insurance stuff sounded pretty good. I want to leave my wife and kids an extra $2 million and kind of buy some life insurance from you. And I said, you know, Crohn's or leukemia or diabetes or cancer. Usually kind of the after. Basically get it early, get it young, so that, you know, the premiums are really small.
So like they won't let you buy life insurance?
Not when you have a pre-existing condition. So this is all the facts. This doesn't work if you don't believe in it, and if you have a pre-existing condition, it doesn't work. So it takes another toolbox out of your, you know, your toolboxes. You can solve problems. You basically threw away a toolbox. Most of the time I hear, well, I'm young, I don't have kids, I don't see that. That's usually what I hear. Where I was always, I want to buy as much as I can, as cheap as I can for as long as I can. So that if anything ever happens, everybody is taking care of taxes, mortgage, business loans, everything goes to the heirs, debt and tax free. And then we'll say thank you for the mortgage. Okay, so that's it. Okay, any others on the exam? Or did I cover pretty much? What time do you have?
7:46.
It's almost 8. Yes. Do you want to do like a 10-minute, and then I'll come back and do the last page?
Yeah.
And then we'll do the movie review stuff. No, I'm trying to think. I want to do evaluation. Okay, we'll do the evaluation. Take a 10-minute break, do the evaluation, and then we'll watch part of the movie, and I'll start meeting with everyone else.
Is that it?
If we need more work, I'll send you back to fix it, and then get it back to you. I'll give you like 5-10 minutes. Don't look at anybody stuck down. Yeah, this is your target model portfolio. This is it. That's the ratio.
Has he publicly mentioned it?
Okay. Yeah, so you do something like that. So if you take what you did here, make sure it's in full form. Okay? And then narrow this, make that bigger. Okay? Make sure it's all times around. Then what we'll do is we crunch this stuff up here. And then we start putting it in this one. Put the technical stuff in between there and I'll catch you each other. Okay? And then I'll work with you. Make sure you put in any of these, you need to start putting in square footage or metric tons or, you know, cost of construction. You know, you got to put some numbers in there to give them an idea of how much you can look at you.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's how much square footage, tons of concrete, you know, put in with metric volumes and then bolt this. So I think there's a lot of work that you can do.
Right?
Just take these and make this look good. And then we're going to work on this. You can shape this up.
That's the best here.
So you got to do it. Remove these pictures.
No. I'm just finishing up because I know he checked on me.
Did he collect that?
Perpetuity. the perpetuity model is the cash flow next year divided by your expected return. It's going to give you the value under the perpetuity model. Now the cash flows next year. Cash flow next year is the cash flow this year thrown out using some growth factor. So if I know what the cash flow is, I think it's going to grow at 10%. I can multiply this year's cash flow by 1.1 to get next year's cash flow. Now, are you guys all familiar with future cash flows? Present values and future values and those kind of things. Does everybody understand that stuff?
Yeah.
I'll go over it in the examples. And then I'll do an example and show you how to do it. And what you need to do is in the on the course website, I listed the book, okay? And it says it's listed on the course website. And it says present values. Right? So you got to go back and you got to review future values and present value calculations. Okay, future value, present value. It's in the liniment book. And I put that on the website. I have all the chapters that go right to the website. I would read them. Okay. So the first thing we do is we get next year's cash flow. Now these cash flows. Valuing the firm. Let's say I'm valuing a real estate investment trust. Well, I can get the funds from operations, which is analogous to a free cash flow for the REIT. Valuing a startup company or a company that's been around maybe 3 years, corporation C Corp, I'd be using EBITDA. Earnings before interest, taxes, depreciation, and amortization. That would be my free cash flow if I was doing a startup company that's been around for maybe 3-4 years. If I'm doing a REIT, I'm looking at funds from operations. If I'm looking at a really large company, another corporation, probably going to be using earnings. So I use funds from operations for a REIT. I use EBITDA for a startup company. I use earnings for a large established company. Depends on what you're doing. So you get, and the cash flows can also be FFO divided by shares outstanding. And that's going to give me FFO per share. So instead of valuing the company, I'm valuing the security shares. If I'm trying to value a startup company, I can do EBITDA per share. That could be my cash flow. Or if I'm valuing an established corporation, could be using earnings per share. As the cash flow. Okay, what do you talk about? Firms or securities? Or real estate. So for real estate, I'm valuing the property, I'd be using net operating income. So what am I measuring? What am I valuing? Companies, securities, real estate. The model is the same. And the model basically assumes that these cash flows are going to remain flat and constant forever. So you would take the next year's cash flow and you divide it by a discount rate. It's called a discount rate. Or your your weight REIT stuff to pay any corporate taxes because they pass through the majority of the cash flows to the shareholders. So there's only no tax implication. So I'm just going to leave it in there. There you go. So that becomes this one. So that's your perpetuity one. Okay. And the real estate, I'm using that operating one. The next model, two, is Gordon Brown. Or the constant growth model. Gordon Brown is basically the perpetuity model. I, which is the discount rate, minus the growth rate of the cash flows that are going to grow at a constant rate forever.
I have a mark before you start writing the number two, so this is all part of the interpretation.
This is just the, this is the,
yeah.
So this is the discount rate. It can also be the required rate of return. It can be expected rate of return. Expected rate of return on cost of capital using the capital pricing model. That also be the weighted average cost of capital using that calculation. It depends on what you're valuing. It will determine what discount rate you use. And if I'm an investor and I say I'll have at least 22% rate of return on all of my investments, this is going to be 0.22. Or if I'm a corporation, I've got to calculate the money. Or if I'm an equity investor, it would be investment that I'm going to use the capital loss for this. So it depends on what you're, who you are and what you're investing in. Determines the risk. And it determines the cash flow. But the model is basically the same. And the board of growth assumes this cash flow is going to grow at a constant rate, which means the growth rate forever. So this one assumes constant growth rate in the cash flow forever. So this valuation is always going to be higher than this one because this one assumes the cash flows are going to remain flat forever. Okay. Okay. Any questions? So those are the two fairly simple valuation methodologies. The next one is the multiple approach. The multiple approach. Start off with the cash flow for next year, and you multiply it with some multiple, projected multiple for next year. It's going to give you the value using the multiple approach. So what is the multiple? What would you do? Well, I could use gross rental income here. I could use gross rental income for the property here. Coming off from the rent. And then what I can do is I can go find the sales price of a recent property that just sold. And then I can divide that by the gross potential rental income. Basically get a gross rent multiplier. So what I can do is I can go find three properties. I know what they sold for. I know what their gross potential rental income was. I can come up with a look at the multiples of those three properties. Apply those multiples or an average of the multiples against my gross potential rental income to get the value of my property. So I can do that. Or what I can do is I can take 1 divided by I and get a multiple benefit that way. But I can also get a multiple by taking 1 divided by I minus. So you can also create multiples from the perpetuity and from the Gordon growth law. So that's the multiple. And as you start to read the literature, you start to see this stuff. Yeah, because we're getting into the valuation part of the class. So we're getting into the evaluation stuff. The first two books are just introduction to the asset class. Now we're going to get into valuations. We're going to start moving really quickly into valuations. So the next model of the discounted cash flow or DCF. Now this is the one you're going to live and breathe. Because the books going forward now are all discounted cash flows. You've got income statements, projecting out rents, vacancies, cash flows, expenses, net operating income, cash on cash, over the holding periods. And you're going to discount this cash flow back to the present, and then you're going to subtract out the purchase price, and you're going to see it in that present. You're also going to be running internal rates of return. If the internal rates of return are going to be higher than your weighted average cost of capital and the cost of your equity, given $5,000. So what we're doing now is investment decisions. We're going to be moving into that pretty quickly. So under the discounted cash flow, what we're trying to value is the present value. And does it say how many years? No, it doesn't. So I'm going to assume a 2-year holding period. Okay? A 2-year holding period. So under the discounted cash flow, obviously you got last year's cash flow, right? 1 plus G is going to give us cash flow plus 1. We're going to discount that cash flow, 1 plus I to a 1. And we're going to actually discount that. So you need to be versed in your calculators and how to do exponentials. Okay? How to take things to the power. To get the discount factors, because you're going to use the discount. The cash flows, and then you're going to add up all the discounted cash flows to get the present. In the next period, what you're going to do is you're going to draw out year one's cash flow to get CFO T plus 2. You're going to discount that cash flow by 1 plus I to the 2. Okay. And then what I do is I go like this. So now what we need to do. We need to calculate the terminal value. The value of the property from which we are going to sell it. Okay, so what is the value of the property when we sell the property at the end of the second year? So we need to come up with the value of the property. So what you need to do, and this is where the students totally mess up, so you need to make sure you understand this. So what you need to do to get the terminal value is you need to grow out the second year's cash flow at 1 plus G to get CFO T plus 3. So you got to grow it out 1 more year. Now what you need to do is you need to make a decision. Do you think the cash flows are going to grow at a constant rate forever? Or are they going to remain flat forever? If you're going to be conservative, then you assume that the cash flows are going to remain flat forever, and you use the perpetuity model to get the term out. You think the cash flows are going to grow at a constant rate forever, then you use the Gordon growth model to get the terminal value. Then you take the terminal value and you add it to the last year's cash flow. You have the terminal value to the last year's cash flow. And then discount it with the second year discount. Discounted cash flow. Year two, the first year cash flow divided by the discount factor, discounted cash flow. Year one, sum them up, get your present value. Yep.
You said use the Gordon growth when you think what?
You think these cash flows are going to grow at a constant rate forever? Use Gordon growth. You think they're going to remain flat forever, use the perpetuity model.
What would be an example of each of those?
Well, I just want to be conservative. So I'm buying the property. I don't want to do a worst case scenario and assume that the cash flows are going to remain flat forever. So I'll use perpetuity. But if I want to be aggressive and think that we can grow the cash flows at a constant rate forever, then I'll use Gordon growth to get a short amount. Then you take the terminal value and add it to the last year's cash flow. Discounted at the discount factor, and get the discounted cash flow for year two. You do the same for year one. Sum them up, get the present value. So if this was a 3-year holding period, I got to grow it after year four to get the terminal value. If it's a 5-year holding period, I got to grow it after year six to get the terminal value. It's a 10-year pro forma, you're going to grow it up in year 11 to get a term from that. That's the procedure that you need to memorize. Okay. All right. Any questions on that? So now we've got the four valuation methodologies. Okay. So now we got the four. So let's do a problem.
Professor?
Yep.
Did you say that you add the terminal value to the second year, or you divide?
You add the terminal value to the last year's cash flow. Wow. Okay. And at the last year's two, you add the terminal value to the cash flow in year two. In real estate, we're using that on the unit.
And then you add it up all the way back.
Then once you get that, then you got to do. Then we have to divide, this is 1.1 to the 2, my discount rate is 10%. So I do 1.1 to the 2, divide that into the last year's cash flow, you get the discounted cash flow for year 2.
And then you add that to all three pieces.
Then I do that, divide by that, and then you sum them up to get the present value. So it's the present value of the cash flows, discounted back.
So you've seen our CF zero. Can we abbreviate C the ones that write it at CF one?
Yeah, it's T plus one.
No, it's it right at. Can be CF one.
No, it's CF two. Because we're growing it out, and that's cash flow two. It's cash flow in the second year. I hate to say it, but the discounted cash flow methodology is a standard in business. So you want to go work in corporate finance, you want to get in mergers and acquisitions, you want to do venture capital, you want to do private equity, you want to do acquisitions in a real estate company, you want to be a security analyst, you want to be fixed income, you want to be a portfolio manager, you want to be a property manager, you want to be a CEO, CFO, you got to know this stuff. Standards. I'll show you an example. So let's do the example here. So real estate acquisitions and development. If a portion of real estate asset has a net operating income of T plus 1, or T equal 1, equal to 100 million, and is expected to grow at 10% from year zero to year one. We got 109. And then actually this is T from zero. This is my net NOI. So currently the net operating income for the property is 100 million. And we have what? The income statement is 3 years. So I'm going to calculate the present value. 1, 2, 3. The terminal value. This is going to be, what's the discount rate? 22%, 1 plus 2, 2. 1 plus 2, 2. Break out your calculators. 1 plus 2, 2, 3. You guys are going to need your calculators. And you're all going to need to do this. Okay? You guys know how to use a calculator? It basically says that I'm going to throw out the cash. What is 1.22 to the 1?
1.22.
What's 1.22 squared? What's 1.22 cubed?
1.82.
Are you doing the calculations or are you just hanging out? What is it?
1.82.
Can you do the calculations?
Okay.
Yeah, break out your calculator or do it on your phone. You guys should be practicing this. So if I grow out 100 million last year's and the current cash flow and I'll get next year's, if I grow out 100 million by 10%, what is it going to be in the first year? What is it? What is it?
110 million.
You got it. Excellent. And then it says I'm going to be able to grow it out at 8% into year two. So what do I multiply it by? Test question. What do I multiply this by if I think it's going to grow out? At 8%. What is it?
1.08.
Thank you. Okay, so it's 110 million times 1.08. You should be, have your calculator, you should be doing this.
108.
What is it?
110
million times 1.08.
118
million. What is it? How much?
118,800,000.
So let's just round, just to keep the math easy. So, 119?
Sure.
Okay. Got it. And then what does it say? It's going to grow at, what, 5%? So what's, what am I going to multiply this by?
1.05.
So what's 119 million times 1.05?
125.
What is it?
125.
Excellent. Got it. And then don't we need to grow it out one more year? Yep. And when we do that, when we grow it out at?
5%.
So what's 125 million times 1.02? Now, what do you think? There's not a lot of detail here. This is just a theoretical, simple theoretical level. But I have to ask you, do you expect the cash flows to remain flat forever or grow at a constant rate?
Grow at a constant rate.
Grow at a constant rate, okay. And what's that rate?
Still getting close to
1.03. So inflation, right? Long-term inflation rate has been roughly 3% for the last 67 years. So we can just use that. And then what's the discount rate that we're gonna use?
22%.
Here's a test question. Do you think the physical structure of the building, the physical structure, that the building will not be subjected to any functional obsolescence or physical deterioration over the next 10 to 20 years?
False.
Right? So as new buildings come online, with new materials, and new floor plans, and new technologies, the building's gonna be subjected to functional obsolescence and physical deterioration. So would you use the 22%? If the building's gonna be more risky and more obsolete and more physically deteriorated, is there more or less risk in the future?
More risk.
So would you use a higher or lower discount rate?
Higher.
So what do we use?
If it's 3%, I mean, how long are...
No, we got the 22, I got 22% here, so what do I use? If I think that there's more risk in the property in 20, 30 years from now, and I'm gonna use a higher discount rate, and I know that the discount rate is 22%, then what do I use?
1.22.
What?
1.22.
Well, we said that the risk was gonna be higher.
30.
What?
30.
That's a little too high. This is
28%.
Like, usually use like 150 basis points. So 200 basis points. So 2 percentage points. Each percentage point is 100 basis points. Okay? So what would that be? If I had 200 basis points, then 22. Percent would be 24%, exactly. So what's 0.24 minus 0.23?
0.21.
What's 128 million divided by 0.21?
Where did the 0.23 come again?
He said that he felt that the cash flows could grow at the inflation rate forever. That's what he told me. He said, you know, we think that the building's cash flows can grow the inflation rate, the long-term inflation rate forever. The long-term inflation rate over the last 60 years has been 3%.
So 609 million.
What is it?
609 million.
609 million. So our terminal value, value in which we think we can sell the property for at the end of the holding period is $609 million. And then what do we do with the terminal value?
We add it to the cash flows.
We add it to the last year's cash flow, and what does that give us? So what's the total cash flow in the last year of the holding period?
$734
million. $734
million.
Is that correct?
Yeah.
Okay. I usually need validation and verification because when I'm usually doing this in front of investors and clients and senior management and stuff like that, if somebody throws out a number and it's not confirmed and the number's wrong, and I walk through the valuation and the numbers are wrong and I make the wrong recommendation, do you think I'm going to keep my job?
No.
Okay. So what's 734 million divided by 1.82? 403 million. Got it. And then what is 119 million divided by 1.49? 119
million?
119 million divided by 1.49.
80 million.
What is it?
80 million.
And then what's 110 million divided by 1.22? 90 million. Okay. That's 90 million plus 80 million plus 403 million. What is it?
573.
507. 507.
73.
property service group is 73, sorry.
Got it. 173. So based on our expected return of 22%, our growth rate assumptions, the assumption that the cash flows are going to grow at a constant rate forever, along with the increased discount rate, we come up with a present value of the net operating income of $573 million. How much is the acquisition price? What is it? How much are they selling it for? How much?
2 million.
What is it?
2 million.
Did it say 2 billion?
2 billion.
Yeah.
Is that right? So the acquisition cost is 2 billion. So what's my net present value? What's my net present value?
Negative what? Negative
1.4. No, no, no.
1427.
Is that right? Is that what it is? So 1,427,000,000. Negative. Based on the negative net present value, would we guide this project? We would reject it. Okay. All right. If I increase the growth rates here, would the present value go up or down? If I increase the growth rates, I can get the present value to go up, and if the present value goes up, does the net present value go up or down? It goes up. If I lower the discount rate, and I go to 12% instead of 22%, what's going to happen to the present value? It's going to go up. And what happens to the present value? Yeah, it shrinks also. And what about if I use a 14% instead of 12%, or 24%? What happens to my terminal value if I lower the discount rate, the terminal discount rate?
It goes up.
And what happens to the present value? It goes up. What happens to the net present value? Get it? Okay. What if I increase the terminal growth rate? What happens to the terminal value? If this goes up, what happens to the terminal value?
It goes up.
What happens to the present value? Goes up. What happens to the net present value? Goes up. So you might need to go back and reiterate your assumptions. What do I need to accept this project? What does my net present value need to be?
Positive.
Zero.
Zero, right? If it's negative, we're going to reject it. So let's just hypothetically say, if we really want this project, could we go back to the seller and ask for a price reduction?
Yeah.
And what would be the amount of the price reduction that we would ask from the seller to get us to accept this project?
$1.4 billion.
Yep. So you ask for a price reduction in the amount of the net present value. If you can get it, the net present value is zero. And when the net present value is zero, do you accept or reject? First thing they do in these things, underwrite these properties, get a negative net present value, and go back to the seller and ask for a price reduction in the amount of the negative net present value.
And when you go to the seller, do you show them that?
And then if the seller says no, I'm not going to give you a price reduction in that amount, then the question is, what do you do next? And you want the property.
Do you recalculate
your numbers? Yeah, you recalculate. So you go back and you check your growth rates, your discount rate, terminal discount rate, terminal growth rates, and you rerun it and see if maybe you made a mistake. Do people make mistakes when they do this stuff? Because it's complicated. This is simple. This is simple. The hard part is putting together those spreadsheets. It takes months to put this stuff together. To get all the research, to get the leases, to audit the leases, to figure out the cash flows from the leases, and then project out the rental revenue, project out the vacancy, project out the expenses, cash flows.
Is this basically like the leases that one of you guys built?
Yeah, that's good enough.
No, I'm saying, like, if you were to make more.
Yeah, I already provided you with all of the Excel spreadsheets.
I know, but I'm saying in a real world scenario, you want to purchase the property.
Yeah, you would use this. This is a very simple underwriting process. To basically come up with an investment decision based off the net present value. The net present value approach is the number one investment decision making tool. To stand. Did you have a question?
If this was a large firm wanting to purchase a building for that was $2 billion, how big of a team would be working on this one particular?
For a $2 billion development, like in New York or Mission Bay or Salesforce Tower, if it was Salesforce Tower development, I would have construction guys, a civil engineer, environmental guys.
No, I mean trying to just figure out the value.
This part,
yeah.
I would probably have, maybe a senior CFO, CEO, COO, and then I would have like a chief, managing director of underwriting, and then I would probably have a team of like five people under me that would be putting together all the components of
those
this.
Those are the ones doing the grunt work.
Everybody's piecing it out, and then somebody's pulling it together, and then they're stress testing, running sensitivity analyses and scenario analyses around this to be able to come up with an intrinsic value. If the intrinsic value in some cases are, the MPVs are too far off the point, you go back and you review everything, and you still just can't get the MPV to get positive. There's one more iteration called the real option calculation that could actually turn the net present value positive. But I'll get into that next week. I won't do that because I think we've already done that. I want to get the validation, and I'll come back and do the investment decision. You know when you have some presentation, right?
Look at it as a chance to improve.